has, I've been interviewing him for basically 20 years now. Congressman John Shimkus from the 15th Congressional District in Southern Illinois. Congressman, welcome back to the show.
It's great to be with you, McGraw. Thanks for having me.
You are always welcome here. So before we get to some of the local stuff, it's pretty historic. You're a West Point grad. You're a NATO guy. Pretty historic what we're watching here in the next 24 hours.
It's unbelievable. Last year, I was able to go to the DMZ with a congressional delegation, and of course I served in the old east-west German border. I was in East Berlin during the Cold War days. It's kind of like unbelievable that we're at least a point where there's discussion going on about hopefully denuclearizing North Korea. Who else could have done that? This is a very interesting presidency.
Yeah.
But you can't argue with the fact that at least they're talking.
Right. Are you worried about anything? They have been prone to make all sorts of agreements. They've been prone to break all sorts of agreements. They're prone to sort of say one thing, do another, use us to maintain their grip on power. Do you have any worries in the next 48 hours?
Well, I think the regime is still going to maintain their grip on power. They're not going to denuclearize without that. I did follow the Clinton administration when they cut a deal to give them food, but then the Jiang regime continued to move on nuclear weapons construction. So, yeah, I think there's always a concern. I don't think we should go in this with a Pollyannish view that that all will be perfect, but I mean, they were lobbing missiles, I mean, into the Pacific. So the fact that that's not happening, I was able to see the theater missile defense system in Guam, and that was moved there just because Kim Il-jung II was saying, we're gonna strike Guam.
Right.
We're not at that point in time, and let's see what happens. You asked me to prognosticate.
Right.
I can't give you whether this will be successful or not. All I know is that they're meeting.
Right, yeah. And talking is better than not talking.
I think so.
Yeah. Let's stay on NATO for a second. President Trump seems like he's treating our enemies better than he's treating our closest allies.
I don't disagree. See, I always talk about President Trump as being a populist first.
Right.
He rose to power through populism. Was one of those guys that used to be a Democrat or was an independent, supported both parties, really seized hold on this malaise of an economic activity. And really, that's part of this whole trade issue.
Right.
We've got Granite City Steel and the trade war. But yeah, I the great thing about my involvement with NATO, having served in West Germany, was that we're democracies. We all believe in the rule of law. We have transparent governments. Those are things that should unite us. We're allies in the war on terror. We have our forces are deployed in dangerous places together. Now, do we always carry the preponderance of the burden? Yeah. So I think that's part of the frustration too. Is our allies have to be full allies, not just have a couple units there and we transport them there. So that's all part of the debate. I don't like the position we're in when we're screaming at our friends.
Right.
I don't like that.
A little history. I was at the Brandenburg Gate in Berlin, and then I was at Reagan's library. And you know this better than anybody, but when Ronald Reagan said, tear down this wall, which, by the way, the anniversary is tomorrow. He was told by George Shultz and others, you can't do this.
Don't say that.
You can't say this.
Yeah, right.
And it was pretty extraordinary that he did.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
So, I mean, you don't know what the future holds. But that was pretty extraordinary at the time.
Well, and some people, now I wouldn't compare the two presidents, but some will use that as an example of this gut ability of Trump to say things that no one else will say.
Right.
Hopefully moving the ball forward. I think sometimes our challenge is we don't know which way the ball will be moving.
Right. No, you don't. Right. You know. I mean, that's the thing, right? I mean, today it looks terrible. Tomorrow it's a brilliant idea.
Right.
When they bought the Louisiana Purchase from France for $15 million, it was a folly.
Right.
It was the dumbest thing in the world.
Yeah, right.
But if you ever go to Reagan's Library, have you ever been there?
I have not.
Oh, shame on you.
I know. I've been close. I'll get there. I've been to the ranch.
Okay, I have not been there. So I don't have the inside access you have to the ranch. I just went to, I paid my ticket and went to. But they have the speech, and they have handwritten. He has in there handwritten with a little arrow. Mr. Gorbachev, tear down this wall. It's pretty interesting. Okay, all right, so that's where we are with Congressman Shimkus. Closer to home, you wanted to touch on, what did you want to touch on? Two things here. One, you have a nuclear bill coming up.
Well, we're dealing with closing what we call closing the nuclear fuel cycle, which is we have nuclear power and we also have defense waste. And I've been spending, seems like my whole career, trying to undo the Obama Harry Reid legacy of not closing that fuel cycle. In other words, there's federal land in Nevada that's a desert. That's a mountain, and that's where we passed a law that it should go.
Right.
And that's the spent fuel, like at Callaway here in Missouri, or Clinton in Illinois, or our defense sites like in Hanford, Washington. And we're supposed to consolidate that stuff and store it.
In the Yucatan Mountains up there.
In the Yucca.
Yucca Mountains.
Okay. Yeah.
All right.
So that... But it's been, we finally passed a bill on the floor of the House about a month ago, 340-72.
Right.
The importance of that was to send a signal to the Senate. There is a lot of support, bipartisan. There was actually more Democrats who voted for it than against it. And so now hopefully the Senate will understand that this is something that's really the will of the elected representatives, at least in the House, that they should do something. The frustration with me is, Harry Reid, because he's from Nevada, blocked this for 8 years. Well, now we have Mitch McConnell, Republican, protecting Dean Heller, Republican in Nevada by blocking it. So it's politics at its worst because it's stopping the will of people and trying to remedy a problem that we've had for many years.
The opioid crisis, not getting any better. What are your thoughts as you watch this?
Well, we've moved about 50 bills through the committee. Energy and Commerce is another 20. Simple things like allowing hospice nurses to dispose of pharmaceuticals, especially opioids, to something that I'm doing is if you've got some remedial pain medicine that's not opioid based, not addictive, but costs a little bit more, maybe be in best interest to pay for to allow us to pay for the higher cost of the drug so you don't fall into the ability of addiction. Some of these terrible stories of young athletes who get
regular, I mean, unsuspecting teenagers who go and get their wisdom teeth pulled out. And 3 years later, they're shooting heroin on the street corner.
So there is other ways that opioid pain medicine has been the cheapest form. And then I think the doctors are starting to understand you just can't send someone away with 50 pills anymore.
Yeah.
Now I think I think some of the docs are worried, and there's a group of the community that are in chronic pain. These people are in pain every day. They use this medicine to be able to get out of bed. I've met with them, and they are afraid that that they'll have to go every 3 days to get another prescription. Our healthcare professionals and our docs have to be able to have the ability to, for people who have chronic pain, to be able to give them a week's supply or a month's supply versus those who need just a short-term relief. 3 or 4 pills.
Well, there is no easy answer. If you shut off the pills, then they're going to gravitate towards the heroin.
Exactly.
And so you've solved one problem, but you've created six other problems down the line.
Well, and it's the whole, you're right, self-medication.
Right.
Then you fall into this mental illness type issues debate also.
Not easy. The Senate and the Congress allocated money for rehabilitation. But again, that's sort of fraught because there is no one way to go about you know, if you break your leg, and we had an epidemic of, you know, broken legs, there's a settled science on how to solve a broken
right,
leg.
Right.
But there is no settled science when it comes to getting off these drugs.
Well, and really, as I found out, and a lot of people who get involved with this, is that bed locations for people, inpatient rehabilitation, which sometimes, especially on mental illness or drug rehabilitation, you almost have to have inpatient care and then outpatient care, and it has to be a spectrum of care. And we just haven't done a good job with that, because we're starting to do better as far as a society say, it's a disease, we need to help them, versus you drug addict, you did this yourself, or you're mentally ill, but that's you.
Right.
And you know, now we understand that we ought to have care and compassion and try to...
Well, and nobody lives on an island.
No one.
And you know, okay, fine, turn your back to these people, but they're in your neighborhood, they're in your schools.
Right.
These kids, you know, it's everywhere.
Right, right.
Before we let you go, Congressman Shimkus, you're a telecommunications guy. Today starts no longer the net neutrality rules. Where are you on all this?
Yeah, I was all the whole net. I think it's a political debate. Net neutrality, the rules that the last administration tried to put in, attempted to take the new communication system and put it under 1933 Ma Bell rules.
Right.
And that's where the frustration was, instead of moving public policy, because now we have spectrum, we got satellite, we've got broadband, we got fiber, copper, and we have a lot of choices. So, and then a lot of people get confused as to what's throttling, what's throwing down, do people still have access?
Right.
And they do. So I'm pleased that we have, we've turned the clock back so that we can be under the current 21st century system.
I don't know about you, but this net neutrality is one of those issues where I believe the last guy I talked to. Right? Because I'll talk to you like, makes sense. And then somebody will call in an expert who has, you know, explains to me why net neutrality is a good idea. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
So I don't know.
Yeah, it's,
I don't know what the right
well,
answer
they,
is.
They got a great name, net neutrality, right? And then they say, well, look at the interstate system. And do you want the federal government to build interstate highways and everybody has free access on there? That's the way they'll say it. But we still have HOV lanes, right?
Right.
We still have... So it's not as simple as people who want to portray it in the processes. And the issue is, do you really want government to be the police on the on the beat?
Okay, but how worried are you? The other side says a Netflix will have a harder time starting and growing because of these net neutrality laws that are going away.
Well, first of all, we never had these net neutrality laws when they got started.
Right.
So,
right.
You know, so it just begs that question is, would we have I don't even use it. You got to be careful now, Facebook
or
Twitter. I mean, they're not really in favor right now. But they were under the old rules. They weren't under these new net neutrality rules. So really, they're going to be inhibited. And guess who does most of the throttling and controlling? It's what we call the edge providers. These are the edge providers are the Yahoos and are the Googles. And they're the ones who are throttling, in other words, allowing data to flow. They're the ones who are controlling access, not the pipes.
Right.
And then the last thing I'll say is, would you want more interstate highways or less?
I'd want more, but I'd want Mexico to pay for them.
That's right. So in wanting more, you have to incentivize someone who's going to raise capital, assume risk, and build that next interstate highway.
Right.
So I've always said, if you want more, faster speeds, more access, you can't have a government controlled system. You have a free market incentivized system.
Yeah. And I also say that if AT&T gets caught throttling back somebody else's, that's going to be such a bad PR move. That people will leave AT&T in droves.
It's only, again, it's against the law. The FTC, that's the other debate. Yeah, you have all these acts. The Federal Trade Commission is that agency that's supposed to control that and police that, not the FCC.
It's amazing anything gets done. It really is amazing.
Who says it does?
Congressman Shimkus is 20 years. He hasn't done anything in 20 years. What is your 20 years, what are you most proud of? What's your most proud of vote in the 20 years you were there?
Well, I think the biggest thing that we've done is probably have seen the some of the infrastructure development and some of the water resources development stuff, some of the farm bills. I'm still fighting the renewable fuels debate,
right.
which is we're trying to address that. There's things that are tough. I mean, the wars and the terrorism and all that stuff that you've had to go, and some of those votes turned out well, and some we're still struggling with that. So,
well, you're always welcome here, and you're always a thoughtful, interesting, non-bombastic politician. I don't know how you've survived all these years. Something is clearly wrong in the 15th district over there. Congressman John Shimkus, Republican, you're always welcome. Thanks for coming
in. Thank you, McGraw. Good